the item that you were referring to yesterday. So the Board of Health's report is here with the recommendation. Licensing and standard is here without a recommendation. So.
Don't hold your hand like that.
Why?
Do that.
That's the Italian in me. Okay, so but we're going to be dealing with both of them, like both items. So we have questions to staff. So if you have any questions to staff, please put your name up, request to question staff. Councillor Doucette.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker, to the Medical Officer of Health, I guess. The report which came before the Board of Health explained why we are, the recommendation is to ban this use of hookahs in city licensed premises. Could you explain briefly the health impact this smoking does, whether it's nicotine or herbal?
Yes, Madam Speaker, the practice of smoking hookah is harmful to health in three ways. For the user, who inhales toxins, which we know through research is associated with a range of chronic health problems, lung disease, heart disease, and cancer, similar to the kinds of health outcomes that occur with other forms of tobacco smoking. Secondly, hookah smoking models a more positive view of smoking than we would like to see, and there's been a long-term effort to try and denormalize smoking to discourage young people from taking it up. And thirdly, for people who are bystanders, such as people who work in premises where hookah smoking is allowed, we have evidence from Toronto studies that the air quality is very poor and would be hazardous to health for exposure over the long term. So, for example, one recent study estimated that for someone exposed to 2 hours of air in a hookah bar was equivalent to smoking 10 cigarettes.
So following along on that line, am I correct that we heard at Board of Health that one of the local universities, as a frosh week break the ice process, had encouraged or offered the students to sit down and have a hookah party, I guess it would be called. Is that correct? And did
yes. I? Over the past couple of years, hookah has been featured as an orientation activity, and I've written to the presidents of universities within the City of Toronto to alert them to the inappropriateness of this. One of the things that we have learned from surveys of young people is that they generally do not appreciate the health risks associated with smoking, and there is a with smoking hookah, and there is a false belief that somehow the hookah pipe removes the toxins within the smoke and is actually safer than smoking cigarettes.
One of the things I've also read recently is when you go to a hookah bar, you may be smoking this, whether it's tobacco or non-tobacco, for a period of time. When you smoke a cigarette, it's you smoke it and it's done. Is that correct? So is it a longer exposure to the substance?
Well, people who are users of hookah will often stay in a premise for some time. It's a social activity. I think the longest exposure is experienced by people who work in these premises, and that's a real concern for health.
Can we go on to the other side of it? So the recommendation is, as I say, to ban it. This is to protect the youth. We are going to be educating. What areas have, what are other areas doing? Have other places banned it? And if so, who? And is that just in Toronto? I mean, sorry, just in Canada? Or is it across the world?
Well, this has been an emerging issue as a health risk and has been recognized by the WHO in their work on tobacco as being a health problem that needs to be addressed. A number of jurisdictions, both in Ontario, other parts of North America, and internationally, have legislated restrictions or bans on the use of hookah.
So we would not be the first doing this?
No, not even the first in Ontario.
Okay. And I understand there was actually several countries who've also banned it, even though it seemed to be not a tradition, but a sort of a cultural way of meeting your friends and things. Is that correct?
Yes, there have been legislative restrictions enacted in countries where this is a long-term traditional practice.
You mentioned very quickly about secondhand smoke. I found that interesting because when I first was sitting at Board of Health, I didn't realize that there's secondhand smoke. So have we found that the secondhand smoke will have the same health effects as someone smoking a cigarette?
Well, a recent study of air quality, which measured things like carbon monoxide and small particles in the air in premises here in Toronto where hookah smoking is offered, did find those contaminants at hazardous levels to health, exceeding recommendations by, for example, the US EPA and Health Canada.
And how would we be able to say if someone is smoking nicotine or if they're smoking herbal? Is there a way for someone who's going to inspect to see what they're actually smoking? That's my last question.
The pipes, the hookah pipes can be used to smoke shisha containing tobacco or a product which does not contain tobacco. It's sometimes difficult to tell from the packaging and labeling whether there is tobacco in it or not. That's important because currently in Ontario, indoor smoking of tobacco in a hookah pipe is illegal. The province recently introduced regulations which give us the authority in enforcement to seize samples to be tested, but it is a cumbersome process, and the evidence is that even hookah smoking with non-tobacco containing products poses a health risk.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Councillor Palacio, questions?
Thank you, Madam Speaker. To the Medical Officer of Health. At the Licensing Standards Committee meeting, we had deputations and there were a lot of concerns with regards to this item. Did the Ontario Tobacco Research Unit brought any concerns with regards to the shisha smoking, especially with tobacco?
Yes, Madam Speaker, the Ontario Tobacco Research Unit conducted the research that I referred to a moment ago, in which they went into a number of hookah-offering premises here in the City of Toronto and took samples, which they analyzed for air quality. I mean, if you go into one of these places, very often you can visibly tell that the air quality is poor, but their tests revealed that there were high levels of carbon monoxide and the kind of fine particles which penetrate deep into the lungs and are associated with health risks in terms of lung disease and heart disease. Those levels were such that the study authors concluded that this was a hazardous environment, both for the smokers and for the non-smokers who worked there.
So that concern is further compounded with, in terms of air quality also, the way that the whole smoking process takes place with charcoal and whatever else. Can you expand a little bit more?
Well, the product which is burned in the hookah pipe, the shisha, is burned using charcoal. And actually many of the contaminants come from the charcoal. It's actually indoor combustion, a bit like having a hibachi indoors. So the combustion products are a combination of combustion of the shisha itself and of the charcoal. So that's why it's less important what's being burned than the fact that there is combustion taking place.
Thank you. Is there any evidence that substantiates that minors, 10-year-olds or 12-year-olds, that they frequent these locations?
Well, there are no legal restrictions currently as to who can enter a hookah bar or, in fact, who can use hookah other than if the hookah is found to contain tobacco. So one of the concerns is exposure of young people to this practice and what message it sends to them about the healthfulness of this practice.
So the difference between tobacco hookah and mainly tobacco shisha, that has nicotine. How about any herbals that are used in the process? Is there any evidence that there is any other substances that that may be harmful to the environment?
Well, studies which have compared the smoke that comes from a hookah using a tobacco product and one using an herbal or non-tobacco product find that essentially from a health point of view, the risks are very, very similar. The only difference is the absence of nicotine. And even that's difficult to be sure about because when studies have been done in premises which believe that they are using shisha which doesn't contain tobacco, there's still nicotine levels in the air. So I think there's a quality control issue in terms of what's in the actual product.
So at the moment, the way things are, there is no rules in terms of forcing the establishments to have a list of ingredients or packaging materials that people know exactly what's being consumed there.
That's correct.
So there is no rules whatsoever with regards to that. I have a couple of questions to the Executive Director of Municipal Licensing Standards. Is there any evidence that shows that these establishments maintain proper ventilation within within the premise?
So through you, Madam Speaker, that is not an element that we would be involved in inspecting, sir.
So we don't have any evidence to that effect?
We've not had any complaints in that regard that I'm aware of that we have inspected against.
How many establishments do we have throughout the city that the city knows at least?
I'm sorry, that the city...
How many establishments do we have that provide shisha or hookah bars?
So through you, Madam Speaker, we don't license hookah consumption. So the information we have is anywhere from 60 to 80 establishments based anecdotally on the information from public health and ourselves.
Has there been any charges or any convictions for those who are... I understand that there is no regulations at this point, but in terms of serving minors or whatever else, is there any has there been any charges or on violations?
So through you, Madam Speaker, we are aware of a number of locations where there have been incidents. We are not involved in inspecting or investigating in relation to alcohol consumption. In respect to smoking, I would defer to the Medical Officer of Health in that regard.
That was your last question.
Half of the premises that we're aware of have either been warned or charged for existing regulations having to do with tobacco.
Thank you. It's getting very noisy in here. Everybody is talking. Please. We have members of the public that are up there. If they can please try to keep it down. I don't know. Okay. Councillor Karagiannis, question.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Through you to staff. Can you please advise us if the places that have alcohol, any of the places that also serve alcohol and food, have been charged?
So through you, Madam Speaker, I would ask, charged with what?
Having either tobacco or the property serving tobacco?
Yes, there have been charges. For example, as of this month, I believe 10 establishments have been convicted under the Smoke-Free Ontario legislation for a variety of existing provincial rules, violating a variety of provincial rules.
Could you be more specific? Have any of them been charged for serving tobacco?
Yes, there have been charges related to shisha tobacco.
In order to avoid minors, this is people under the age of 19, from going to these places, and also allowing the people that want to smoke hookah, would you be adverse to having establishments that only serve coffee, tea, or juices? To operate and have strict control that there's absolutely no tobacco products are permitted?
No, my recommendations to City Council are in the reports before you.
What do we say to individuals that want to partake in smoking and want an establishment that they can frequent to do that? And I'm talking about the cultural group in the Middle East, the South Asians. What do we say to them? Continue smoking at home and continue smoking tobacco at home and pollute your house? Or would we rather have an establishment which is safe for them to smoke?
I think we would take a similar position to other legislation affecting smoking, and that is that it does not regulate or limit smoking in private spaces, such as homes.
I believe there's four establishments that allow people to bring in, I think these are downtown, that allow people to bring in marijuana in order for them to smoke in their establishment. Am I correct?
That's not something that I have any information about.
Would any other staff member heavy information?
Through you, Madam Speaker, we are aware there are a number of locations that are called compassion centres for the consumption of medical marijuana.
Would you be also moving to shut them down?
Through you, Madam Speaker, the matter before us, sir, is dealing with shisha and not the issue of medicinal marijuana.
So if somebody was to get a doctor's note that said that they need to smoke shisha for medical reasons, how would you react to that? Through you, Madam Speaker.
I would report the doctor to the College of Physicians and Surgeons.
Would you be also doing the same for the doctor prescribing the patient to smoke marijuana?
Well, there is a legal framework in place in Canada for medicinal marijuana.
So there could be a framework for allowing people to also smoke hookah?
I doubt that, given that I'm not aware of any health benefits of smoking hookah.
Yet. My other question to you is, wouldn't it be safer for people that want to smoke hookah to have a place, an establishment to do it, something similar to the folks that are addicted to crack or cocaine, and we have a safe place for them to shoot up, if I can use the terminology?
In terms of tobacco, for many decades now, we have not pursued a harm reduction approach because, particularly for tobacco use and smoking in public places, there is third-party harm. In other words, a premise such as you're suggesting would still pose a health risk to the people who work there.
But the people that work there, I would put it to you that a lot of them are smokers and they choose to work there.
Well, similar arguments were made in the past about people who work in bars and restaurants. And we heard from people who worked in bars and restaurants who were very much against being exposed to these hazards in the course of their work.
Thank you, Madam Speaker.
Thank you. Councillor Campbell, questions?
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Well, we were reminded by Councillor Matlow that we have a new government in Ottawa. I guess he's the Prime Minister now, on his campaign trail indicated that they will be moving toward the legalization and beyond the decriminalization of marijuana. How will the medical officer of health respond if hookah bars become transformed into marijuana dens? Because this is a different type of herbal, will we be similarly looking at a ban, notwithstanding federal legislation legalizing it?
Madam Speaker, I'm not sure whether this is before us, but I would say that if there is a legal structure put in place regulating marijuana use, then any enforcement activities would operate within that structure, I presume.
So has hookah, shisha, whatever it's called, I never even heard of this until the report landed in my office.
No, but me too.
Is this under federal regulation?
No, it's not. It's currently a largely unregulated activity, which because of its hazards is why this is before council.
So the hazards posed by smoking are well documented, and the linkage with cancer is well documented. Have there been similar reports linking this practice to the onset of cancer or other diseases?
Yes, there have been, and those are referred to in the report.
Are they referred? If they have, I missed that. Okay. Because I get the carcinogens and the linkages there. Can you just help me out and tell me what those linkages are?
Well, broadly speaking, there have been long-term studies of people who are chronic users of hookah, and they have been found to experience many of the same health effects that tobacco smokers use, including lung disease, chronic lung disease, heart disease, and cancer.
All right, so would, in your professional opinion, are the harmful effects of this practice, are they similar to marijuana use?
I'm not really able to comment on that because we haven't looked at that issue specifically. There are chronic health effects of marijuana use. Marijuana use is typically not as intense as tobacco use.
Well, we're not talking about tobacco use, we're talking about hookah use.
Or yes.
Shisha, or whatever it's called.
Well, so, hookah is a combination of tobacco and non-tobacco products. So.
But we're looking to ban the entire practice. Strip out the tobacco, it's the herbal you know, so even if it was 100% herbal, we'd be looking to ban it, correct?
Yes, that's correct, because many of the contaminants don't actually come from the shisha. They come from the combustion process.
So just getting back to my question, we are looking to ban this practice for the, you know, consumption of herbals, and in 12 months' time, is it not foreseeable that we might be faced with this discussion again were the federal government to legalize marijuana?
I'm perhaps not making the same link between the two issues that is being made in the question.
All right, so we're about to ban a practice on the use of the consumption of herbals because it's not federally regulated. So we have the authority to do that. The federal government has authority to legalize marijuana. And if they do so, we will have banned a practice. I'm just trying to find out what is more harmful. We're banning one practice, whereas the federal government may legalize a practice down the road that is equally harmful. And I want your professional opinion if they are equivalent in their potential harmful effects.
I would have to report back on that. I'm not in a position to give you that comparison today.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I'll wait till it comes.
Thank you. It is getting very noisy in here again. Councillor Matlow.
Through Madam Speaker, and actually, if Councillor Campbell, this may assist because I understand where Councillor Campbell was going, but just to clarify, regardless of whether we're discussing cigarettes, hookah pipes, or marijuana, this isn't about banning or not banning. We are specifically discussing the usage of any of this in licensed public establishments, regardless of any of these subjects. Is that not fair to say?
The recommendation that's before council is about a prohibition in city licensed establishments. That's correct.
Exactly. So my inference would be that it would be it's a red herring if we're looking at other types of smoking. It's just a matter of where we're smoking. However, my question is more to do with how we set the priorities of what kind of recommendations come to council through the Board of Health. So recently, the World Health Organization reported that processed meats, like bacon, lamb, etc., are carcinogenic, that they can lead to cancer. Are we expecting a recommendation from you that we should ban all processed meats from Toronto?
I'm not doing any work on that right now. I don't see the connection. I mean, there are many things that we experience and are exposed to in day-to-day life that can pose a health risk. We don't choose to regulate all of them.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So I think it's fair to say that while we might have roughly 70 known hookah bars in Toronto, processed red meats are fairly ubiquitous. You get them at virtually every restaurant and most of our households. So soft drinks. I remember Mayor Bloomberg in New York City made an effort to ban large-sized sodas, and eventually the courts threw that out. But do you think it would be wise to consider doing that in Toronto, banning soft drinks, because we know that leads to obesity and serious health problems?
There's no recommendation on that matter before council today from me.
So what I don't understand is, I think it's fair to say that most of us, those of us who don't smoke, rarely come in contact, if ever, anymore in Toronto with anyone smoking in most every establishment we can think of, whether it be nightclubs, bars, cafes, barbershops, you name it. Most of us rarely even think of it. Most of us can't even believe that we once allowed that, frankly. It seems like so long ago, even though it wasn't that long ago. So why are our really a handful of establishments that cities like New York and other cities have actually even grandfathered in having special provisions for. Why is this the priority that we're debating today, rather than, I think, what a reasonable person could argue could be much more challenging issues, such as processed red meats, sugary soft drinks, all these other things? Why is this one on the table and the other ones aren't?
I would say two things. First of all, the smoke-free, generally smoke-free public places that we all enjoy in Toronto were significantly contributed to by legislative action taken by this city council in the past. It helped pave the way for a much healthier environment for all of us.
I agree.
I don't think that a question of action or inaction on one health issue bears on what we do on another unrelated issue.
I'll speak to it, but I still am confused why this specific item is here when there are so many other issues that people do in their day-to-day lives that affect our health. And how do we as government pick and choose what do we want to sort of get into and regulate and enforce or prohibit, and then what do we believe are things that are up to adults to make decisions about? And I'd like to explore that more.
Thank you. Councillor Mammoliti, questions.
Madam Speaker, someone with a very strong accent came up to me the other day and said to me, do you know where I can find a good hookah? And I sent him to Councillor Karagiannis's ward. He called back and said, I don't want to smoke. But on a serious note, it's been a few minutes.
Councillor Mammoliti, your time is running.
So my question really does relate to, I guess I'm most concerned about following up with Councillor Campbell's questioning. And that is, the herbs that they put into these things are health. We're being told that the herbs are also very dangerous to our health that they put into these things. And Councillor Campbell's questioning, I think, makes sense. Because in another couple of months, if these herbs are actually replaced with marijuana, how would you feel about these kinds of lounges? Would you say the same thing?
As I said in response to an earlier question, much of the contaminants which are of concern from a health point of view actually come from the charcoal, the burning process, not just from the product which is put in the pipe. I'm not aware, I think it'd be speculative to talk about marijuana being used in this way, so I'm not sure how to respond to that question, but regardless of whether the shisha product has tobacco in it or not, we're facing the same kind of health risks.
I know, but I get it, and I understand your report. I understand where you're coming from, and I understand the responsibility you have to educate us and the public on this. But we all know that this direction is happening federally, and it's going to happen relatively quick. I think it's going to be swift. And in that particular case, if these kinds of lounges opened up and called them marijuana lounges, how would you feel about the effects that marijuana brings and not the herbs?
I would have to look at that issue as a separate issue and report back on it.
So do you think that it might be worth just deferring this off for a few months to see what the federal government actually does? And maybe you can look into some research in terms of what the effects are of marijuana in these machines?
I would say that the reasons why this is being recommended will not change, regardless of what happens with marijuana.
So if they started a lounge with marijuana, it would still be unacceptable?
I think we would have to look at that situation and see what the health risks were.
All right, so let's say after the federal government does their thing and we open up, or you see a number of commercial properties selling marijuana and them smoking in those commercial properties, what if there were one right next door to one of these? We would crack down on this before the marijuana lounge?
Well, Madam Speaker, when it comes to the hookah bar, we have a body of evidence about health risks. We have models of regulation which are successful in other jurisdictions. The work has been done to justify this recommendation to council. When it comes to something which may happen in the future, we would have to look at it.
All right. We may want to look at that sooner than later as it relates to this machine, because that's what I see it as a machine. The other question is, what if they decided to take these machines outside? Do we have a bylaw that says you can't do that either?
Well, currently, the proposal is for restrictions within licensed premises, whether outdoors or indoors. If it's part of the premise, then the smoking would be prohibited.
So they could actually take these outside?
Onto a patio, as long as it was part of the licensed premise.
Okay. And the economic question has to come up. We're making revenue from all of these businesses. They pay they pay one form of license or another, whether it's food, whether they're selling something. We make revenue. What's the revenue we make on this industry total?
So, through you, Madam Speaker, it's difficult to break out strictly those that are related to hookah, shisha. The license fee for an eating establishment, which we believe most of these are licensed as, is just under $300 per license. If we presume there's 70, that would be $21,000 a year.
If this report goes through today, we effectively eliminate an industry completely. And do we have a plan to make up that revenue that we're losing currently with this industry?
That was your last question.
So through you, Madam Speaker, I mean, in any given year, we see businesses exit and enter the city, and there is a fluctuation in respect to the number of licensed premises. So it would be very difficult to say what the net impact would be if 60 premises didn't get replaced.
Thank you. Okay, are there any further questions on the two items, Board of Health and licensing? Okay, we'll go to speakers. Councillor Mahevic.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. Here, just on the other item. This issue is a very interesting issue, and you know, I want to place a bit of context on this.
Councillor Mahevic, do you have a motion?
Yes, I do. I have a motion that basically puts on the table.
Okay, just a sec. Let's put it on the screen. Okay.
Yep. Carolyn Bennett.
That's from Public Health, and this is the one from Licensing and Standards that gives effect to the Board of Health motion and puts it in a legal frame, the proper legal framework. And the date is changed to April 1st. It was October 1st for because the reports were deferred for a little while, so it's now April 1st. So let me put this in a bit of context. You know, we do a lot of things around this council chambers, and of course we do many, many good things. But I'll tell you, in my years here at council, if someone were to ask me, what is the thing that you are most proud of as a city councillor? You know, I might say the Wychwood Barns, I might say St. Clair, whatever, I might say other things. But you know what? You know what actually? One of the things that would really be at the top of my list would be the smoking bylaws that we put in place about 15 years ago. In the 1970s and 80s, when we were in university, I remember the pipes that would come into the tutorial rooms and the smoke was filled, and there was lots of 50% smoking in the city of Toronto and frankly in the country. In the 1990s, it was 25% to 30% smoking in the city of Toronto and across the country. Then we had all those debates. This council chamber was filled with restaurateurs in the mid-1990s saying no to the idea of restricting smoking in restaurants and eating establishments. It didn't happen. City of Toronto and North York put in place the bylaw, and we were all set to in the city of York, but then there was such an outrage that it didn't happen. 5 years later, the mayor of the time, Mayor Lastman, said, yes, we got to do this, put in place the bylaw, and that time, the demographics had started to shift. That 25% had gone down to something like the low 20s, and there was enough of an experience of smoke-free restaurants that people, Torontonians, said, we have a taste for this, we want more of it. And so in the early, about 12 years ago, 15 years ago, we put it in place, and it happened. And you know what happened? The smoking rates in the province of, in Toronto went from the mid-20s, now they're somewhere in the mid-teens. 10% reduction in the last decade or so. What that means is that there are literally tens of thousands, and because it spread and became a provincial law and it went to other jurisdictions across the country, and frankly, it also, we're part of a global movement in Europe as well. We have been part of a movement that has saved tens of thousands of people, hundreds of thousands of people that have not contracted health diseases like heart disease, cancer, all kinds of other diseases that are related to tobacco and cigarettes. That's what this is part of. That's part of this. It's kind of like the butterfly effect. You know, we sometimes talk about a little action here will save lots of lives and lots of illness down the road. That's the only reason why we're doing it. So it's the right thing to do, and I think when, you know, when our careers are finished and you're going to look back, you're going to say, that one was a good one. And we can't identify who is going to be the beneficiary of that policy. But we do know statistically this is going to drive down the numbers. And when you drive down the numbers, all those numbers are real people who will be positively impacted. The standard, we're now in the teens, you know, California, they're around 7%. They have a smoking rate of 7%. They have done tremendous work in this area. The health argument, I think the Medical Officer of Health has articulated that very well. The cultural argument, you might say, yeah, but there are cultures that really, really do this, and we can't go against that, those cultural practices. Well, we know that Israel, South Africa, Saudi Arabia, Namibia, Russia, Vietnam, places, South Asia and Middle East, they are restricting this practice as well. We're always changing as societies, and they are changing, and they are figuring out that this is not something that they really want to have their culture wrap themselves around. This is the right thing to do. It's got all the right endorsements from the medical community, tobacco control research unit, lung association, cancer research groups. This is the right thing to do.
Thank you
very much, Madam Speaker.
We do have a question for you by Councillor Campbell.
Question. Could we have the motion on the board, please? I think you said, Councillor, you said licensed establishments.
Yeah, establishment. I'm using the wording, frankly, I just took it from the report.
What I'm getting at, it's licensed establishment. What if it's an unlicensed establishment? So a licensed establishment, you mean an establishment that sells food and liquor. What if it's an unlicensed establishment? I mean, if you're like, personally, I don't know how I'm going to vote on this, but if you're going to cover the bases, you might as well cover all the bases.
You can't operate an unlicensed establishment.
Like a bakery. Is a bakery a licensed establishment?
Yes. To operate a bakery, you have to have a license.
All right, so what if it's a reading den? What if it's a bookstore? A bookstore is an unlicensed establishment.
Oh, you have to license them.
No.
A bookstore is
an unlicensed establishment. So I don't, so you have a, you, I think you might want to recognize that you've left a loophole.
Well, I'm not sure we have, but I will check that with staff. We don't want to leave a loophole.
Just pointing it out.
Yeah. If there is, I will amend it, but.
Thank you.
Okay, before we go to the next speaker, Mayor Tory, you would like to make an announcement at this time regarding Take Your Kids to Work Day?
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Councillor Robinson indicated earlier on that there were joining us today, quite literally in our building, hundreds of people from grade 9 as part of Take Your Kids to Work Day, and the second shift, she introduced the first shift, which had her son and Councillor McMahon's niece in the crowd, among others, and the second shift, and I don't want to mean second in terms of in our affections otherwise, but the second shift, the next shift, is here, and I just wanted to welcome them and acknowledge, as we had planned on doing during their visit, welcome them to City Hall, welcome them to the Council Chamber. Things are pretty good this morning on the behavior front, so I don't need to apologize yet for anything you're going to see. It isn't always this good, but you can see, I think, because some of the students I met earlier on in the earlier group were asking me what we were debating, and I said we were debating something that was actually quite important to young people in the context of smoking and you know, an issue that's not easy. None of them are, because there's some other side to this that you're hearing being presented as well. But we welcome you. I will say on behalf, I'm sure, of my colleagues, it was so interesting for me when I was up having some pictures taken upstairs to also meet the public servants who have their children here today, because you don't get a chance to meet the parents who are also here, and we welcome them also, and to say thank you for the work that they do. And I hope you have an understanding not only of what goes on in this chamber from your visit here, but also a better understanding of what your parents do, because I can assure you that the work they have chosen in public service is fundamentally important to the well-being of the city and to the working of the city properly. It's very important work that they do, and I think important work that we do as well, and we work together as partners. And so I hope that you have a chance to observe that firsthand as well today. So I will just say welcome. I hope you enjoy the day. I hope you learn something about local government that's good. We will try to stay on our best behavior, and I will look forward to coming up and having a chance to say hello to you, as I'm sure some of my colleagues will. You're most welcome.
Thank you. Next speaker is Councillor Palacio.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I think what's before us today is two sets of recommendations, one from the Medical Officer of Health, and the other one is from the Executive Director of Municipal Licensing Standards. And that's to make some changes or amendments to the Toronto Municipal Code, Chapter 545. To include definitions on the hookah use. And so that's in the inhaling and exhaling of smoke from activated hookah pipes. And furthermore, to prohibit the use of this substance in licensed establishments. So that's what's before council. It's not. We are not dealing with marijuana at this point. We are not dealing with regulating any aspects of it. And I think that's stretching a little bit to it. So in terms of the smoking, as we all know, the Smoke-Free Ontario Act of 2006, it prohibits smoking in enclosed places, also in workplaces. And that includes illegal hookah lounges that serve tobacco shisha, and as it's been indicated, I believe that we have more than 60 establishments out there. So I also understand and I believe that the hookah smoking should be banned, and there are many reasons why I support the banning of it. Is for me, it doesn't matter if it's cigarettes, cigars, shisha, tobacco. Smoking is smoking, my friends. And all of that should be subject to the same rules and the same regulations. I don't smoke, and I have a good understanding of what it takes. Actually, I became a victim of secondhand smoking against my will, and that was at home. To the point that I developed a serious allergy. And that's another aspect that I had paid close attention to, the negative impacts and effects of smoking overall. To allow this hookah, shisha, tobacco smoking in licensed establishments, In my opinion, it amounts to have a separate regulatory framework that would be different from the Smoke-Free Ontario Act. And that in itself, it will not have legal fit or enforcement rules. During the deputations, we heard loud and clear from deputants from all over. Smoking is smoking once again. Doesn't matter if you're smoking cigarettes, cigars, or shisha and tobacco. The negative impacts of secondhand smoking goes beyond what is being actually recommended. One of the things that is very concerning is that hookah has gone beyond being a social and cultural practice that's been practiced in other parts of the world. This is a new phenomenon mainly with young people. And I do say young people as well. I have my daughter that very often, yes, they socialize with their friends and they get engaged into these small parties. And that's where I learn from it as well. That this goes beyond the traditional and cultural roots and traditions that where this kind of smoking takes place. This is something that's cool out there to many young people, but the harm that's doing, especially to the younger people, when you have 10-year-olds or 12-year-olds, as the medical officer of health indicated, when they did a survey within our local schools, at least 10% of those students are frequenting these hookah places or hookah lunches. That's very, very concerning. So it's a growing phenomenon with young people. It's something that it will impact the health of not only of those who are inhaling or exhaling, but also those who work within those establishments. And the secondhand smoking is something that we should be very concerned and with regards to that. So from that perspective, I encourage members of council to approve the recommendations that are before us from both reports, that's from the Medical Officer of Health, as well as from the Executive Director of Municipal Licensing Standards.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Councillor De Bearmaker. Okay. Councillor Karagiannis.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. There's a motion that I have, if the staff can put it up. Thank you. My motion is for us to establish a new regulation, hookah lounges, and only to allow non-tobacco products to be permitted, food or liquor not be permitted on the premises, only coffee, tea, juices to be permitted, and minors under the age of 19 not to permit it with signage in a prominent location, and we should look at licensing them and have an appropriate fee on these. I understand that a lot of my colleagues are of the view that we shouldn't have any of these locations, but however, I will put it to you that if we bring these regulations in, there will be absolutely no tobacco smoke, so we are able to get around that. There will be no minors that would be invited to come in. There will be no food, and as such, a lot of people that right now are enjoying food, liquor, will not have the availability to do that and wouldn't be able to do that. On the other side, this is a cultural practice that has been done in many countries, although they've tried to abandon it, the regulations are not working. In Egypt, for example, where there's a high cancerous rate and the country has come up with abandoning this, there were discussions, there were turmoils, and country backed out of this. So I would say that we move in this direction. People that want to smoke will continue smoking. If they don't have a place to smoke, they will be smoking at home and they will be smoking real tobacco, putting their families at harm and at risk. if they have a safe place to go and smoke, like we have safe places to smoke, to light up for marijuana, and we have a vapor, I think they're called vapor lounges, and we have places in other cities where people that are hooked onto drugs can go and shoot themselves, safely shoot up. This is the same. This is an addiction, and we got to work with our communities in order to provide for them a safe place for them to have that smoke and actually have a fee that we can actually regulate and go at times to make sure that these lounges do not have any tobacco products. So I put it to in front of you for consideration, and I hope that I can get your support. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
Thank you. We do have questions. Councillor Burnside.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. So I'm not an expert in this by any means, but how does one tell the difference between smoking tobacco and smoking whatever else you're talking
about? If you're importing, and a lot of these times people are importing them from overseas, there's Health Canada that has regulations, and there's actually stickers on them. And if people try to break those rules and regulations, RCMP will sweep down, they will confiscate the product, and they will charge you. I know of a case in my former riding, where a person was fined up to $250,000 for trying to bring in molasses, but it was really tobacco. So there is regulations, and there are stickers. The Health Canada clearly states them. So our inspector can go in and take products and make sure that the stickers are there, and also analyze the product. That's why I recommended that we do have a business license fee in order for us to be able to do that.
So we have enough inspectors to figure
well,
that out.
Once you start charging a license fee, I mean, I have recommended a figure, but okay. Unfortunately, I can't move it. Once you have a fee, then you have an inspector that goes to, or two inspectors that go to two or three of these, I mean, to the 50 or 60 places that are there, and there's some in your ward. And people
really?
Of the South Asian culture and the Middle Eastern culture that you have, a lot of them actually frequent them.
Okay, thank you. And is it your contention? I thought I heard it that people, if they have a establishment they can go to, will go and smoke molasses as opposed to staying at home and doing tobacco.
At home, usually people will be smoking up tobacco.
But they would. Okay, and what's the addiction part? Is it the tobacco or the molasses or both?
Tobacco is the addiction part, but molasses is, there's absolutely no tobacco product in there.
So if you're addicted to tobacco, you're going to leave your house to go to an establishment where you can do molasses.
In your ward...
That's fine. Sorry, it was somewhat rhetorical. It's okay.
It's all right. I'll answer you. In your ward alone, I would say to you that a lot of the male population, especially people from the Southern Asian, as well as the Middle Eastern, are frequenting these bars very often. And you will find the people that are there, probably about 98-99% of them are smoking molasses versus staying at home and smoking tobacco, which could be harmful to their families.
Thank you. Thank
You're welcome.
Well, that's something new. Councillor Mammoliti? Councillor Cressy?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I will keep my remarks very brief on this subject, as I don't think they need to be too long. And in doing so, I'll stick to the research and the facts. For 20 years, we've worked as a city to reduce smoking and reduce the harms associated with smoking. It hasn't just been our city, it's been our province and our country. And today is simply another step in that direction. And I don't think we need to make more of it than that. The research is clear, and we've heard it and seen it in the reports and under questioning, that hookah or shisha is cancer-causing. It is cancer-causing both for the users, those who are smoking the substance, as well as those who are a third party to it, the secondhand impact. But it's not just the health impacts, it's also behavioral, that it normalizes smoking behavior. That is what we have sought to do for 20 years, is not just reduce the harms of smoking, but to seek ways to mitigate and stop the normalization of smoking behavior. And with the increase in shisha smoking, in fact, we are normalizing smoking behavior. We shouldn't do so. And so this debate today, it's not a debate about excessive regulation. People can still smoke shisha at home. We're not stopping it. Rather, it's simply a discussion of how our city should continue with our 20-year trend towards reducing the harms associated with smoking, and in doing so, stopping the normalization of that behavior. And so for those reasons, I'll be supporting Councillor Mahevic's motion, and I encourage others to as well.
Councillor Doucette.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. It's a shame there's not more councillors in their seats. It seems like we're on a third day already. Anyway, I will be supporting both of the motions put forward by, thank you, Councillor Shiner. I will be supporting both motions being put forward by Councillor Mahevic. What shocked me at the Board of Health was when the youth came to talk to us. The youth themselves admitted that they didn't know the health implications, the health effects of smoking. As you heard, one of the universities used it during a frosh week to welcome the students to break the ice. And the students we heard had educated themselves on the health effect. And they took it upon themselves to go back to their fellow students and educate them. I think as a city, as a Board of Health, it is our job to protect people from a habit or something someone's doing that doesn't just affect them, but affects someone else. And that's the difference, and some of the questions we have heard today, that's the difference between some of the things we've been hearing in the media recently. Smoke hurts people through secondhand smoke, whether you're smoking a cigarette, whether it's an e-cigarette, whether it's shisha, it's that effect on someone else around you. I disagree completely with one of the councillors who spoke today who said that people shouldn't have to smoke in their homes, they should be able to go out in public so they don't hurt the health effect on their family. I don't allow smoking in my house, I don't allow smoking in my car. But I wouldn't say, please go out to a public place and affect someone else there because you want to smoke. People work in these cafes, people work in our bars. Why should someone working in these areas to make a living have to suffer the effects from secondhand smoke? That I disagree with completely. The heaven didn't fall. The earth didn't freeze over when we banned smoking in restaurants and in public places. The same is not going to happen now. Heaven isn't going to freeze over. Hell isn't going to freeze over. We'll be banning something to keep our city healthy. So I do support these motions, and I ask you to look at them very carefully. We heard from some councillors they hadn't even really heard about hookahs before this report came forward. I agree, not everyone has. But therefore, have you also heard of a health effect from them? And if you haven't, you're more likely to walk into one of these cafes or hookah smoking places and try this without having that education. One of the things we are doing is we're trying to educate people. You've heard that if you want to take it outside and smoke on a patio right now, you can do that. Maybe in the future you can't. So as I say, we've got to look at this carefully. We would not be the first people to ban this. Argentina, Bangladesh, Israel, India, Namibia, Russia, Saudi Arabia, to name a few, have banned hookah smoking in public. Restricted hookah smoking in public. Quebec, Alberta, New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, they've also restricted smoking. So we are not the first ones to do this. I know we won't be the last ones. So I hope you can support these motions, and let's move forward and keep our city healthy. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Councillor Cole.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I should start by saying, I don't believe that Councillor Campbell has never heard of hookah. I'm actually surprised there's any debate here, really, and I will vote for Councillor Mihevic's motion. I strongly support everyone to do so. Smoking in a public space or in a bar or restaurant is smoking. I don't care what your device you're using to smoke or what's in your pipe. I don't care if it's oregano, tobacco, some mixture, I've heard molasses, and how you're smoking it. As I sit down with my family at that restaurant, I don't want your smoke in that space. It's pretty simple. We've set the standard in Toronto. It's one that not only have we learned to live with, but I think businesses especially have thrived because of it. I know that now when you walk into, say, a pub in your neighborhood where 10, 15 years ago you'd see a few lonely people sitting in the bar crying in their drinks, smoking away, now you'll see families actually sitting there and the business is thriving. So if you're smoking something, you're not doing it in that place. I think it's simple, it's consistent. It, regardless of what you are smoking, I think is irrelevant. I don't actually care what you're smoking. And for the cultural aspect to be introduced is totally a false argument. You could have argued years ago that smoking cigarettes was a cultural prerogative of lots of places around the world, and Councillor Mihevic just suggested that that wasn't introduced into that debate back then too. So I think that, my guess is that this will be an overwhelming majority with this vote, but I certainly will be supporting Councillor Mihevic's motion, supporting the recommendation from health experts, and supporting really what our residents, consumers, customers in the city have told us they want in our public spaces. So I encourage you to do the same. Thank you very much, Ms. Speaker. Madam Speaker.
I know you were going to say something else. I know.
Well, I was going to make a bingo reference, but I refrained.
You know what happens at bingos.
I know.
I still love you, Francis.
Oh, I've never heard of molasses before. This is the first time I've heard of molasses. Councillor Mammoliti.
Councillor Fletcher says, now you're going to hear about it again. I don't profess to be an expert on this at all. In fact, in my ward, there are none of these lounges, and I cannot stand up here and say that. And Councillor Karagiannis says there are. Well, if there are, I certainly don't know about it. I know about some of the other lounges that I'm trying to shut down and have been trying to shut down for quite some time. But in this particular case, I have learned a little bit about what's going on. So I get where our health department's coming. I get where the councillors who are opposed based on that argument are coming. And I get why some councillors feel like they need to get rid of the industry. I don't necessarily agree on how we're getting rid of the industry, because there are 16 shops, I think, 16 recognized lounges in the city. 16, 17 of them. And if you put numbers beside them, that means that you're shutting down an industry and the revenue that's coming to the City of Toronto when you shut down the industry. Now, I heard staff responding to my question about how much money we're actually losing and whether we can replace it. And the response was, well, businesses shut down every day. And we are regularly looking at that. Well, maybe businesses, small businesses, do shut down every day, but it's not every day that this chamber shuts down an industry and the money that comes from that industry. There's a big difference between one business and shutting down 16 or 17 shops with one motion or one report. And so for that reason, I would have preferred to do a little more study on this, to look at what the federal government is going to do with respect to its new marijuana laws, and how that's reflective of what's going on in Vancouver. Because what's going on in Vancouver is everybody's smoking up. The whole city's smoking up. And they're doing it in these shops. And right now these shops are illegal, but nobody's touching them. So how is it that we're after this particular industry, 16 of them, and we want our gung-ho on shutting down an industry, but yet in other provinces, they're letting people smoke up wherever they want. That I don't get. And I say that with all due respect, because I know what's coming. I know what's coming. What's coming is the federal government's going to open the doors, and these other commercial properties and lounges are going to be set up. And then we're going to ask the question, is it healthy? Are they carcinogens? Do we worry about people smoking in these shops? And as of today, nobody answered that question because they said, well, we're not dealing with that today. We're dealing with this today. So even if we wanted to replace the herb with marijuana, we didn't want to answer that question today. Why? Why is it that we don't want to answer that question? And I'll tell you why. Because when the federal government makes marijuana legal, these shops are going to pop right back up again under a different form. Right? So that's why we should have deferred this. Defer it. Let's see what's happening. Let's talk to Vancouver. Let's look at how they're dealing with it. Let's find out why they're not throwing their enforcement officers out there to shut them down. But not only in Toronto do we get a sense that we have to be involved with everybody's life, that we know better than everybody. Right? Only in Toronto. That's a made-in-Toronto approach. And this council feels like we tried to ban shark meat, for crying out loud. You know, you remember that big thing that Councillor DeBaker, the big shark that just, it dove down just like the attempt did by the city. The courts ruled us out of order. The courts said we're out of order. I just feel that while I understand the report and understand why the responsibility of our officials needs to be with these reports, to come in and do what they're doing with the reports, I think there was room for us to just wait and see what was going to happen. And the cultural part of this equation, people are joking about it here. I hear them joking around the cultural stuff. It's not a joke. Some people feel like this is a part of their culture, and we should have listened to that as well.
Thank you.
And we haven't.
Thank you. Councillor Matlow. And then we'll go to Councillor DeBaermaker. Councillor Matlow.
Madam Speaker, this has been a very important learning experience for me. I came into this debate at Licensing and Standards Committee with a very strong feeling, and I think it was more of a feeling than an informed view, that this was frankly a waste of time, this debate. The vast preponderance of establishments, licensed establishments in the city, are non-smoking. The average person does not come in contact with smoke in licensed establishments on a day-to-day basis. And I just didn't see any reason why we need to be sort of, in my view at the time, nitpicking at sort of this specific use in these specific places when, as I was, you know, asking my questions earlier, there are so many other health risks in our society, and how do we pick and choose? Is this city council going to be debating every single possible thing that could go wrong and try to fix it or step in or create prohibitions and bans and restrictions? Is that our role? Do we want to be that sort of nanny state type of government? I don't think so. I don't think it's good for us to step into every single thing. But my position has been evolving based on partially the arguments that I've heard from those who have been advocating for this restriction, but also largely based on the arguments from those who have been trying to push back. The reason I've been influenced by those who have been advocating for this prohibition is because, as Councillor Cole said, intellectually, if you're an honest person, how do you actually decipher between like what is a good combustible product and what's a bad one, and how it affects your health? I mean, if somebody is smoking something in a public place and you and your kids are there, you will be affected by it. And there's no honest way to argue against that fact. That's just a fact,
and I would be dishonest if I suggested otherwise. When I hear arguments from those who have been pushing back on this prohibition about things like, well, what if marijuana is legalized? Well, then I expect that you can legally do it at home or walking down the street, or maybe, I don't know how it's going to look, but you still probably wouldn't be able to do it at a restaurant, just like you can't smoke a cigarette. I'm not confused by that. I think it's kind of simple. So I don't like this debate. I still hold a view that in a different world, it would be maybe better if there were places, if you wanted to go and kill yourself, you go do it somewhere, you know, that's kind of safe and legal and doesn't affect other people. But I don't know how to do that yet. And I don't know how to honestly say that somebody else won't be affected by that behavior. And until I do, then I will have to support Councillor Mahavik's motion, because I think the arguments for it have been strong, but the arguments against it, I just don't buy. So, thank you.
Thank you.
I listen.
Councillor De Beermaker.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I will be supporting the staff recommendations and Councillor Mahavik's motion, and I'm very glad we're doing this. And unlike my colleague, Councillor Matlau, who doesn't buy the arguments, I do buy the arguments. There have been concerns that we are perhaps becoming a nanny state or are a nanny state. By definition, we are all nannies. This council, our job is to regulate public behavior. Our jobs are to protect people. And when you protect people, that's a nanny state. We tell people, all of us in this chamber, that we should, that we and our children should wear seatbelts. Perhaps people forget the outrage that happened when the government told people, when you get in a vehicle, you have to take that piece of material, put it across your chest, and click it into the seat beside you. There was outrage. The nanny state, how dare they tell us what to do? I'm a safe driver. I don't need to wear a seatbelt. And even if I'm a fast driver, I should have the ability to choose whatever I want to do. Well, I can't imagine there are many people in this room that would say, you know what, it's okay not to wear a seatbelt. Is that the nanny state? Yes, it is the nanny state. The nanny state tells you to put on a seatbelt, and if you don't, we're going to give you a ticket. The nanny state tells you not to smoke in public places, not to smoke in offices. When I first started working for Councillor Doug Mahood back in 1990, he was a chain smoker. Our desks were adjacent to each other. They touched each other. We were in the same office, maybe 3 or 4 feet apart. He smoked from the second he walked into the office to the second that he left the office, and frankly, never stopped, I guess, until he went to bed. But we don't allow people to smoke in offices anymore or this building anymore. It's a nanny state. The nanny state says to you, you can't smoke in the Toronto Council chambers because there's going to be health impacts, not only on yourself or on other people. It was controversial at the time, even in this building, but we passed that legislation. Being from Scarborough, when the city of Scarborough was passing its no smoking regulations that would stop people from smoking in restaurants, there was a huge outcry. Every single restaurant owner in the city of Scarborough signed petitions, had the BIA coming to us saying, we will all go bankrupt because the nanny state is telling people that they can't have a nice cigar or cigarette, smoke a pipe in a restaurant. We'll all go bankrupt because all people have to do, especially back then, is get in a car, drive north of Steeles or east of the Rouge National Park, 5 minutes away and you're in another municipality. Well, it didn't happen. People who said that they were going to go bankrupt are still in business. I asked during our staff reports, are we aware from our Economic Development Department or our Medical Officer of Health of any restaurant in the City of Toronto going bankrupt because of our no smoking bylaw? Not a single one. So for the restaurants or the cafes that are allowing people to smoke hookah in them, they're not going to go bankrupt. People will continue to go to their cafes because they want to visit their friends, they want to meet after school, they want to meet on the weekend, and they all serve food. In fact, Councillor Karygiannis at the committee meeting suggested perhaps we should not allow, if he wanted them legalized, that they should not be allowed to serve food. And the reaction in the audience from the people who own the cafes was, no, 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 we want to serve food. Of course the lounge wants to serve food because they make money that way. So there will be nobody going out of business. The health impacts are documented to us. Smoking is smoking is smoking. Whether it's a cigar, whether it's a pipe, whether it's a hookah pipe, whether it's molasses, whether it's an herb, whether it's all of the flavors they give you now, candy-flavored shisha, it's all
marijuana.
Harmful to you and to the person who's working that establishment. So, Madam Speaker, I hope that we will today follow in the very wonderful tradition of this City Council, take a leadership role in stopping smoking and saving lives. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Campbell to speak.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. There are a lot of contradictions in this particular debate that we are a nanny state. Well, isn't this the same council that extended bar hours from 1 o'clock to 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock or whatever it was? And isn't this, you know, for either permanently or also for special occasions? And that was against the objections of the police. So, you know, on the one hand, we're prepared to make these regulations and potentially impact people's businesses. And on the other hand, we're prepared to extend drinking hours, which is obviously, you know, quite a dangerous practice, or can be a dangerous practice. The other contradiction is about the businesses. You know, we hear how the businesses are going to suffer. Well, you know, if your business is solely dependent on people coming in and smoking from one of these sorts of pipes, then it's not much of a business, quite frankly. And I certainly concur with the thoughts that, you know, all of the bartenders and restaurant owners said that their businesses were going to suffer as soon as we took smoking away. And they haven't. And they've continued to thrive. And if somebody has put their life savings in a business, as I heard on Metro Morning the other day, they're going to have to work a little bit harder, but they have to be able to sustain their business on the basis other than smoking hookah. But I think the big problem, the contradiction for me, is I personally don't feel that the Board of Health report was all that compelling. I don't think that the linkages between the smoking of these substances, that there are direct corollaries to, you know, increased risk of cancer. I think that in my view, the report wasn't that strong in that particular regard. Notwithstanding that, clearly, if you're in a room where this is going on, you are exposing yourself to some dangerous toxins. We've heard about secondhand smoke. Well, you know, people can choose to work in these places or not choose to work in these places. Secondhand smoke, I don't know that particular argument is a very strong one, because you can either choose to go to one of these places or you can not choose. The problem is going to happen when the federal government comes down and licenses and makes legal marijuana. How are we as a city going to say you can't smoke marijuana in a bar and get high when we allow drinking in bars? So how are we going to deal with that? So now, on the one hand, we're going to be banning this particular practice of smoking in a restaurant. Are we going to do the same when it comes to marijuana down the road? And I have to say, I think Councillor Mammoliti was somewhat on the right track in saying that maybe we should have put this debate off to another day. Notwithstanding all that, I'm going to support Councillor Mihevic, because I think that the reasons for the health risks, although I didn't feel that they were overly compelling, I think that you know, we do have a job to protect patrons in our restaurants. So I'll be going along and supporting Councillor Mihevic. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
Thank you. Councillor Fillion.
Thank you. Well, it's good to hear that there seems to be good support for this. The objections really are deja vu all over again for, you know, going back to the smoking debates in 1997 and 2000. You know, it was all the same kind of arguments. It's premature. You know, why do this if you're not banning hamburgers? You know, it's wait till some other level of government does something. There's not enough evidence. You know, it's hard to believe now, but the banning of smoking in bars and restaurants was incredibly controversial. It was, you know, difficult to get that through at one point. now see if anybody would dare give those arguments now that they gave then. Even some of the same people in the room here would dare get up and give those same arguments now about smoking in bars and restaurants. Of course, there would be public outrage if you tried to go back on that. So this is just moving forward with good public policy to protect the health of the public. And so I'm pleased at the amount of support here today. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, that's it for the speakers. Our first motion is on the screen by Councillor Mihevic, 1A. Recorded vote.
Councillor Peruzzi, your vote, please.
Councillor Crisanti, please. The amendment carries 34-2.
Motion 1B by Councillor Mihevic. Recorded vote.
Deputy Mayor Minnemong, please.
The amendment carries 34-2.
So, Councillor Karygiannis, your motion is redundant. Item is amended. Recorded vote. Item is amended. Items as amended.
Councillor Robinson, please. Councillor Fillion. Councillor Cole. The item is, or actually both items as amended, carries 34-3.
Okay.